So today we're fitting a 76 series rear bar. These will be exactly the same as a troop carrier, and a JXL and a Workmate are the same. They are slightly different in the wing length, the side panel, but essentially for the fitting, the video will be the same. Now, we've stripped all the bumper parts off this car. This one's obviously an old one. So a couple of things to note. There is a couple of different variants in this chassis depth. So some are straight across. We do supply a couple of packers that go in here if it is this style. If it's straight, you'll just disregard them. And these critters over here. For starters, basically, we just need everything off the chassis. From there, if the car's completely new, it will have captive nuts in the rail. Most of them, like this car, have had a tow bar fitted at one point. So the holes have already been, like, captive nuts have been drilled out and there's already holes. We like to open them up to about 16 mil. And then we're gonna, it comes supplied with a little nut plate, which we're gonna stick in there. Getting nice and lined up. Make sure there's nothing inside that's gonna foul it. The other most important thing at this point, now again, if the car's had a tow bar fitted, like the one that's behind Des here, these holes will already be drilled in the bottom. So if you've got a brand new car and you're fitting the rear bar, you'll be wondering, why did we put a hole there? It's because we did match the original tow bar hole. But if your car's brand new, it won't have that. Don't worry about it. We'll fit the bar and you'll just drill through the bar. However, the most important thing, these are your nut on a stick for that bolt underneath. They do need to get slid up in and out. If you don't do it now, once the rear bar's on, you won't be able to get them in and you'll have to pull it back off. So you can put them in, just leave them sitting there. When you drill your hole, they'll just lift up out the way. It won't matter. Then when the bar's on, you can just reach your finger around and line it up and put your bolt in. So basically, tail lights also. We like to snip it off close to the tail light. You can solder it, heat shrink it, terminate it, whatever style you like to do. But I like to keep the factory plug, and we're gonna join that to the tail light. You can unplug that and do that on the bench if you wish. So a lot of people will do that. Sometimes when they're old, they're a bit hard to get apart. But yeah, basically car is set up like that. The other thing too, you can drill a little tiny hole in the bottom of here, tail light out and tap into reverse, because you are gonna need a reverse feed. These are all the things that are nice to do while there's no bar on. So yeah, open holes up there, nut and the stick in there, sort your wiring out. From there, that car is ready to go. We'll prepare the bar. Now he's preparing the bar. When you get the bar, obviously nothing will be in it. Stub cover if you will be supplied if you're only gonna have one carrier. It's just to keep this nice and clean and it look good. The thread in here, we'll put our 8mm bolt in there just to cap it off. Again, if you're gonna have a carrier, you would be putting the ball in at this point like this one. Tail lights, they don't come with the lights in, they'll come in the packet. Now these, you use a small screwdriver in the end or in the back, they get separate. That frame, pop rivets in there from the front, and then the light will go in and snap in from the front. From there, we're gonna fit the reverse lights, which my rocker up. Now the trick is, because I've got a bit of a bill on the top, to poke them through the hole, get your bolt in, then rock back till it's neat, and line him up so he's flush with the front, do your bolt up, have that all ready. As I was saying, at this point you can wire that to that if you want. Now if you have your tail light in your hand while you do it, you can actually see that one goes the indicator, that one to stop, etc. And the white one's obviously earth. Brown's tail, red stop, white's earth, yellow's indicator, so it's pretty self-explanatory. You can join them up at this point, so when you fit the bar, you just got to plug it in. Our pinch weld that's supplied goes there. It serves no purpose other than to just bridge the gap just to make it look neater. Some people, the rubber trim on the body, you can take it off if you want. We normally leave it on. Again, it's just a looks thing. This is going to sit against your factory mud flap, so you can... we'll rivet that on later, so you don't need to do anything at that end. And the checker top just glues on with Sikaflex or something similar to that, whatever you got on hand. Bar that, we are ready to put this on the car. Alright, so now I've slipped the bar on the car. Now we're going to work through bolting everything on. Start with your bolts in the side. Now, looking up in here, we've got the three here. Now, the chassis on these do vary in width quite considerably. So, first thing when you sit it on, if it's quite snug on the chassis, that's fine. You just rock on. Some do have a gap. So the shim, if you've got that, it's got a gap, you'll put the shim in there, then put your bolt through into our little nut plate. The little nut plate's got that little tab that'll hang out the end. You can hold it with your fingers, get your bolts lined up and go from there. The other next step, bolts up in the middle, very hard to see, but they're captive in the rail. I've just got a couple in at the moment. So what we like to do is lift it up till this tab touches the chassis and you can literally pivot it on there to get this nice and parallel. Bear in mind, these have all been hand drilled for most tow bars if it's not a new car, so they can vary a bit. So those holes you drill in the rail, you really need to be a decent size so you got plenty of adjustment. So I like to get this lined up. It's nice to have the carrier open and you can actually use it to pivot the side, get that nice and parallel, and make sure that there's no gap in the middle so the bar's all the way forward, and then do them up. As I said earlier, some cars, that relationship from the bolt holes to the center is different depending on the year. If you need to, again, there's a packer for the middle to fill that void. It's pretty straightforward when you sit it on, you'll work it out. Line them up, do the three side ones up, do your middle ones up, break a bar and get them nice and tight. You'll then see, if you look up from underneath, our existing tow bar hole lines up with our little brace. You can grab our nut on a stick, which we put in earlier, and line him up and put that bolt in. It's a little bit tedious, but then you can rattle him up. So he's ready to get that done. Bar's lined up, all tight, all done. We're gonna move on to our wing brace. First one, he's gonna come up from underneath. Bolt's gonna go through and into the captive nut. Now he's roughly gonna line up with him. If it's a troop carrier, and there's also two different tank positions on a 76 or an aftermarket tank like this one, sometimes you've got to be careful. You can be back a little bit, so this is on a bit of an angle. That's fine to get, just be very wary that none of this is going to rub on the fuel filler. Obviously, in this one, we've got heaps of room because it's got a long range tank. On a standard tank one, you've got to be very wary of where you bolt that. This can be a little bit either way. So put that in, leave it loose so we can slip him around. And this goes that way. It will fit both ways, but this will rub on the body that way. Something to note, if you are struggling with filler clearance, you can actually put that up the other way. You can put it in from the top, rotate it down, have the bolt at the bottom, and then obviously you've got nothing at the top if you're having dramas with a fuel filler clearance. But on a normal car, this is certainly how it's meant to go. You've got wicked clearance everywhere. Just make big importance that it's up that way because it will fit both ways, and then you'll have good clearance here and good clearance because of the same both sides for the exhaust. Then that's pretty much good under there. Your mud flap, make sure you got your original screws back in everywhere so it's all nice and firm still, and it should sit and all line up basically how your factory bumper was. While we're here, obviously tow hitch and pin that's supplied, we put that in, any rattle bolt. One thing to do that I forgot, when you're fitting the bar, like sliding it on, run him over the top. I can obviously take the plug off and do it, but you've got the holes pre-drilled here for a 7-pin, and these are for an Anderson. And yeah, you'd run him over the top so you can't squash the wire. A couple of pop rivets or screws into there. But everything's notched and ready. You got your recovery point. From here, we're gonna put carriers on. Our next step is we're gonna fit carriers. This one's a single carrier. Obviously, if we're doing twin carrier, doing both. So we're gonna grease our bearings, top and bottom bearing, grease them, same as a car, normal thing. Knock your seal in the bottom, exact same process as doing a trailer hub or any of those. The bottom. We'll put our gas strut on the car ready. Now, trick with these is we're gonna go on and not let the stopper engage. so that we can come right around here. Can then go to wherever we want to make this gas strut go on. And using the leverage of this, we're gonna come around and then get the stopper. So now the stopper's engaged. If you don't do that, because this is now under tension, you'll never get them on later. So from there, we're gonna put our top bearing in. Line up your hole in the castle nut. So just firm, doesn't have to be crazy tight, but obviously a little bit of tension. You can use a large socket. Well, you can't hit this directly on here because you'll dint it, but a large socket normally over the top. Obviously we've got a tool for it. Done. Now something to note when you're going to put it on. Our stopper is here. To put the gas strut on or to remove it, before you put your nut on, you can lift the hub up a little bit so the stopper disengages, let the arm travel right around here, click your gas strut on, and then use the leverage of this to compress it and let it engage. Obviously the reverse when you're removing it, nut off, lift it the 10 mil, let it come around and take the gas strut off when it's not under load. It's very hard to get it on if you forget, so that is the process for that. From there, obviously these are a nut and bolt. They're our M10 button heads with the nylocks on the back. The bar is slotted, so what you like to do is just have your bolts in loose, close him round. Now that's what we're going for, is that the hook is nice and central. Adjust it up and down and then do them up tight. The next step, the latches come roughly adjusted correctly, but we want it to just be like that. Doesn't need to be super hard, just enough that it's got an over center. Whatever you adjust, this one will do your tension, and this nut is purely, so when it's undone, that's not floppy. So if you give this one quarter of a turn, give that one quarter of a turn, move them the same amount. So that should just have a little bit of tension, she'll be able to still turn it. It's just holding the hook where it needs to be, so when you go to activate it, it's easy. And if you want it a bit tighter, a bit looser, give that one, but it only takes a very small adjustment to make a massive difference. That's how we want it to be, super easy. Next step. Wheel plate, put our M16 bolts in here. Now, this distance here needs to be about 10 mil less than the backspace of your wheel. So if you put your wheel flat on the ground, you can measure through, you go, okay, that's 145, and measure here and go 10 mil less, adjust it to where it needs to be. So I'd go 135, do them up super tight. The whole idea is that the tire will have crush on here and it'll stop these rattling loose. Now, depending on what wheel you have, if you've got steelies like this car, you'll turn them nuts around, run them like a normal wheel nut. If it's got the factory alloys, which have got the big hole, you'll run the nut backwards with the washer, which we supply, and so it'll work both ways. The idea is you can chop and change between wheels and the one set of nuts will still work. This gusset on this side is for if you're fitting a light pole. The bolt there, you would back off, slide the light pole in, and just do it up just so it pins it. If you're not fitting a light pole, obviously, just do the bolt up so it doesn't rattle loose, and that's a finished thing. So now we're all finished. A couple of things to double check. As we spoke about with the tire, you can see we've got crush there, so it makes it nice and firm. Check all our bolts are tight, just run back over them again. Run through your lights, check everything's working. Our trailer plug, so the wires are up over the top. Super neat, you can't damage it. And that's it.